Dobrý den. Já vás vítám v kempu na další přednášce ze série Urban Talks. Nebudu mluvit dlouho, protože jsem přišel na poslední chvíli, já jsem tady první týden, takže toho moc nevím. Ani nevím, jestli jste tady nebyli víckrát než já. Já předám rovnou slovo. Vítám vás v kempu, klidně si prohlídněte potom ještě výstavu Smíchov City, pokud jste to nestihli. Je tady ještě do konce týdne, příští týden začíná přednáška Davida Gaberleho, fotografická výstava, která bude z trošku jiného soudku. A potom za měsíc začne výstava Praha zítra, která už bude zase víc o architektuře. Takže děkuju, že jste dneska přišli, užijte si to a pokud budete mít potom nějaké dotazy k výstavě, naše crew je vám k dispozici. Takže děkuju.
Dobrý večer, já se jmenuji Maciej Miłobędzký, jsem z Polského institutu v Praze, taky nebudu hovořit dlouho. Já jsem vás chtěl přivítat jménem spoluorganizátorů, poděkovat kampu za to, že nám tuto přednášku umožnil a za prvé bych vás chtěl pozvat na výstavu prací pana Macieje Miłobędzkého a jeho studia JEMS Architekti, která probíhá ještě do konce tohoto týdne, do neděle v NTK. Začínala v prosinci a teď je právě na finiši opravdu v tom vstupním atriu, nebo v tom vstupním ne atriu, ale foyer Národní technické knihovny, tam můžete většinu těch realizací, o kterých dneska budeme hovořit, tak uvidíte taky makety a budete si o nich moc něco přečíst, takže určitě doporučuji. To je bod první, bod druhý. Rád bych vás pozval na naše internetové stránky nebo na Facebook Polského institutu, pokud vás zajímají všeho druhu akce spojené s Polskem i architektura, protože i architektuře se věnujeme. Myslím, že Polsko je taková land of opportunity pro architekty, protože polská města nejsou převážně tak krásná jako Praha. Řekněme, že ta historie se na nich podepsala poněkud více, což je nevýhoda, ale vlastně ten handicap může být i příležitostí, to znamená, máme spoustu místa pro to stavět dobrou současnou architekturu a taky spoustu potřeb, protože nám řada infrastruktury chybí, včetně třeba té kulturní, které bude do velké míry věnována ta dnešní přednáška. Takže už končím a předávám slovo panu Maciejovi Miłobędzkému z JEMS Architekti. Děkuju.
Thank you. Thank you very much for invitation. Thank you, Kamp. Thank you, Polish Institute in Prague and Kabinet Architektury, who invites us for an exhibition in Technical Library. And I'm not sure if our studio, JEMS Architects, is very popular in Prague, so maybe a few words of self-presentation. We are working together 30 years. This is the jubilee year. This year we will celebrate the 30th anniversary, our studio. I have to run the system. Okay. Now it consists of something like 65 architects, and it's a little bit too big from my point of view. And so what is important that we are not a typical corporate design office. We are rather kind of professional workshops, and the people that are working in our company are relatively young, except our three founding partners, maybe. And what is also important that I think there are a lot of interesting personalities in our team, but there is no one, let's say, predominant personality. It's very important for us to study the same themes through the years, to work on the same things through the years, and to collect our experience and our ideas as a common work. And what should I say now? At the top photograph, you can see us at the day of founding of the company after we won the competition in 1988. And as you can see, our office is changing, our habits are changing, the number of cigarettes, drinking coffees is completely different than 30 years ago. But the main and the number of people increased 8 times, but the core of the firm is still the same. We are working in Warsaw, and at the top you can see the Warsaw from 1970s, and it looks more or less like this in 1980s and 90s as well as when we were founding our company. And the bottom photograph shows the same place in Warsaw, one of the cities in the center. In the city center, 30 years, almost 30 years after the process of transformation. So, at the top floor, at the top photograph, you can see the big housing estate that replaced a dense 19th century city destroyed during the war, and the lower photograph shows the result of the process of the process some people call from the dwelling estate to the city center. I think it's even more than city center. It's a kind of global metropolitan landscape in some ways. And what is And this transformation, of course, has its good and bad things. As you can see, the developers were hungry, and architects too. And so they wear everything they had in their wardrobes, new forms, new materials, and all these clothes architects wear. Their buildings were sometimes, let's say, second hand, especially in 1990s and to the early 2000s. So it looks like you can see here the picture. I would like to say that something like 80% of our clients are strictly commercial clients, and so we are designing office buildings, we are designing housing, so we can see some samples of offices and some samples of our housing projects. But what is important that even in those commercial buildings, we are trying hard to think about the public image of the building and the public space between the buildings, and sometimes it is a source of professional satisfaction as well. And today I would like to say about the 20%. The other 20%, that is 20% left, our public buildings, not because they are intended to public, but also because I believe that the ideas, the architectural ideas we found during the design process are sometimes applied also to we are trying to apply to our commercial buildings as well. And the first building I want to start the presentation with is some people say is the least typical building for JEMS architects, and some says that's why it's very difficult to. And this is the international conference center in Katowice, the capital of in the industrial district. And at the bottom left, you can see this brownfield, the center of Katowice, where there were coal mines some dwelling estates from 1970s, and it's generally we can say that's the post-industrial landscape. And what is very important is this building. You can see on the top photographs, it's one of the most intrigued buildings from 1960s. We call it spodek, that means, you know, bowl or saucer. And this is the sport and cultural events hall, designed in 1960s. It's one of the most iconic buildings from 1960s in Poland, and very sophisticated structure, also in terms of protection the building from the ground problems caused by coal mines damages. And this part of Katowice turned in last 20 years into the new cultural forum, new cultural area. So there are some new cultural buildings like a concert hall for the Polish Radio and Television Orchestra, like a university library, like a Silesian Museum. And some say that it's not good because each of these buildings were designed separately without any type of master plan. And there are also some sarcastic opinions that this is the source of the success of this area. So I don't know, because I haven't seen any master planning for Katowice, for this region, for this part of Katowice. But I think this part of the town now works very well. Here are some examples of the new buildings in this area, the university, library, Silesian Museum, designed by Rigler and River, and Tomasz Konior, architect, project building for the Polish Radio and TV Orchestra. And our idea, the first thing we had to decide is what to do in such important neighborhood. It's a very iconic building, and we were absolutely conscious that we cannot do anything like this. We cannot do any iconic building in such neighborhood. And on the other hand, the Congress and Conference Center it's a very rational and sober building. It's a box. It's a rectangular box that is divided into separate sections, and so you can organize their concert, you can organize their fairs, exhibitions, and so on. So we decided to left it as it is, as a very sober box, and here at the perimeter wall of this building, you can see the longest toilet we have ever designed, and I believe it's the longest toilet in the Central Europe as well. And we decide that it's very important to connect this central square in front of Spodek with new cultural center and with the old miners' village Bogucice. And another thing that was very important was to make this area accessible for public and make this area as a public area, because International Congress Center sometimes works as a public building for those who buy the tickets for concert, for fairs, for exhibitions, but it is not working all the time, sometimes only few days a week or a few days a month. So we were trying to arrange a place that works for 24 hours a day as a public space. And the main question was how to cross that that box and some ideas at the very beginning were rather radical, and finally we decided to design this kind of green valley that links a center in front of Spodek with a new cultural forum. And we were studying a lot of precedents here, and we are always a little bit crazy about the overlapping orders, the urban order, the landscape order, and we're trying to analyze different solutions, knowing from the past, the typical city quarter crossed by the landscape axis, the city as a archipelago of islands, like Aureli says, or the one of the most popular historical plans of Rome, designed by Gian Battista Noli, that shows that that is the public area that crossing the street pattern, and we're also studying the buildings that were very always the source of inspiration for us, like Alvar Aalto and his connection with the connection with the rigid building structure in the landscape, also Pietila in Helsinki, and this is the result. This is the entrance to the Green Valley from the Soso site. And this is also seen through the Green Valley. And we are trying to make this place active and attractive also at night. And there are always a lot of people, even if the weather is not fine. And of course, some people say that it's very popular to design the buildings with the accessible roof these days, and some says that it's a symptom of pavilionization of architecture, and I would say that I agree with these opinions, and sometimes of course it's very funny to see the third, second, or 100th design showing the green hills and the people that are sitting on the hill and looking a bit like suricates or rabbits, but in this particular place it works. This is a real popular meeting place, and there are always a lot of young people. The TV presenters are interviewing people in this area. You can meet them, wedding couple, making photographs, and so on and so on. And some source of inspiration, not direct inspiration, but this industrial landscape, and our facade made of steel mesh, and the similar materials that we used in the in interior, where we added some wooden panels, but the way of lighting, the way we use the materials is a little bit inspired by this post-industrial landscape. And what is the most important thing for us architects is that this building is really popular and in Katowice, and so you can meet all sorts of people there, and you can meet architectural students after training hand drawing, and our team during the last days of site supervision. And I would like to say that the idea of this Green Valley and this intersection of the rigid architectural structure with this landscape passageways, landscape pathways, public pedestrian ways, is something we're exploring also in other projects, like Academy of Fine Arts in Warsaw, like our competition for the Museum of History of Poland, we were using a similar way of thinking, not maybe not similar forms, but similar systems. And also sometimes we were trying to apply this hollowing out of the rectangular boxes also in such public buildings like Museum of Amber in Gdańsk, where we were trying to make a kind of a negative of iconic form. And this is a very specific building that sits on the remainings of all grain stores in Gdańsk, typical Hanseatic city. And we add the new part without, and we decided not to close the door, the walls that are destroyed during the war, to open the view to the old town. So this is a section showing the idea. And here is a part of one of our last commercial buildings, the Warsaw Breweries, where we use similar motifs as in the Amber Museum in Gdańsk. This is the entrance to the underground part of the new office and commercial center. In the underground, there are the remainings of old beer storages. And some pictures showing our competition entry for the Museum of History of Poland, which sits above the highway. Here's the Warsaw Escarpment with Ujazdowski Palace from a part of 18th century axis with his characteristic geometry of triangles. And we wanted to follow this geometry designing the new building, which is also a kind of a bridge between two historical parks, the Ujazdowski Garden and the Botanical Garden in Warsaw. So this building is a series of concrete frame, and the interiors of the building are hollowed out in those frames. And you can see the photographs of the model showing the public passageway from the Polish Parliament through the park and to the Ujazdowski Palace, and the interiors of the building, the staircases, the halls that are open to this public accessible hall. It's a bit effect, a little bit similar to the false perspectives in Palladian theaters. And another building, this is extension of Academy of Fine Arts in Warsaw. Like other public building, is a result of the open architectural competition. And this is extension of the existing building from 1914, designed by French architect Gravier, French-Polish architect Gravier. Some says that the pupil of Tony Garnier. And our task was to add a new wing, very intensive, with a very intensive program. It's a new wing for the Department of Sculpture and Department of Conservation or Preservation of Historical Monuments. Here you can see some photograph from 1920s showing the character of the sculptural studios. And this is the picture showing how it looks like something like 8 years, maybe six years ago. And our idea was to follow the geometry, the geometrical partitions of the old building, and to provide a very narrow space as an open, half-open courtyard that connects this building with the open green areas along Vistula River. There's a Vistula River Boulevard, and this courtyard you can see here, and another phase of this investment was a building that is a kind of information center and library for the Academy of Fine Arts, but this is not executed up to date. It's a little bit similar concept to the one in Katowice. And talking about the Academy of Fine Arts, it's good to mention Oskar Hansen, one of the famous professors of Academy, an architect and artist, who was the author of linear continuous system. It was in 1960s, he was trying to design towns that the linear towns that are linking the Tatra Mountains with the seaside. It's a very specific project. Family houses that sits on a kind of steps, and behind the steps you can, there are parkings, there are roads and so on. And it's 50 years before Bjarke Ingels and his ideas. And Hansen wanted to adopt his way of thinking about linear continuous system and open system in this building in Warsaw. He wanted to make a one open space where professors and students are working together, discussing and so on and so on. His idea was to avoid the situation where the professors and students are closed in their studios. And another idea was to extend the academy to the Vistula River Boulevards to make a kind of exposition and place for cultural events. And Hansen was failed that time. His idea were not continued by the professors of the school. And I must say that he were not succeed too after 40 years and after Hansen. And here you can see the structure of the building is rather complicated because at the bottom there are some sculpture studios, then classes for theoretical theory of art, and at the top there is a school auditorium and a black box that is a stage design studio. And our idea of open space for sculptures. And our way of thinking about the continuation of the old architecture. It's the Vistula River Boulevards. It's full of very interesting buildings, especially from 1930s, like this office buildings for Warsaw Electricity. And of course, we were trying to follow the way of thinking about the composition of facade, but without repeating the material and without repeating the exact partitions. And we are trying to make this building much more rough, much less formal than the office buildings and dwelling houses on the other side, and much more three-dimensional. Which we feel that it goes well with the character of the artistic school. And very important element is this narrow atrium, this courtyard. Our intention was to let the people to see what's going on, the dwellers of Warsaw, what's going on in the artist studios. And on the other hand, it is a kind of window of the academy towards the river boulevards, and I think it works very good, because even if you are deep inside a building, you can always see a part of greenery along the river. And our intention was to design this courtyard as an exhibition space for sculptures. Sometimes it works like this, sometimes not. But especially at night, you can see what's going on inside the academy. And these two photographs I like very much, because this one shows the sculpture studio, very industrial-like space, where all the studios are connected with this industrial folding doors. This is the photographs taken during the building handover, and this is something like a 10 days after. And I appreciate this kind of mess a lot of personal things bring by the students and professor, and I feel that this is strong enough to serve as a background for this living place place of artistic work. And this building I want to show you because that it was very important for us, and a lot of elements we invented and we applied in this building were used in the next years in many other projects. This is the building for the multimedia group Agora, the owners of the daily newspapers, TV projects, radio projects, internet, and so on and so on. And they are started as a company or as a group of people publishing Gazeta Wyborcza, one of the first independent journals after the transformation, after the political transformation. This is the editorial board in the sandbox in the children's garden. This is a picture from 1990s. What was very interesting for us, there were no people who knows anything about business, anything about architecture, anything about building matters in those company that time. There were philosophers, historians, and so on and so on. And that's why I think we prepared together an interesting program for the building. And this man you can see here is Adam Michnik, a former political prisoner and the friend of Václav Havel, and so on and so on. And our idea was to design the building that reflects the expectation of our client. And the expectations were like, we don't want anything like a typical office building. We prefer rather kind of maybe home atmosphere. We don't want steel and glass facade. We don't want typical office ceilings. We don't want typical lighting fixture and so on. Instead of that, we want a lot of places for formal and informal meetings, a lot of greenery, a lot of natural light. And it was very difficult to execute, because this building sits in a very degraded area with some dwelling houses, some warehouses, some post-industrial buildings. And this was very difficult to open outside to the an interesting view and to provide this natural light. And so we decided to design a building that from the distance looks rather solid and closed, but when you are approaching to its facade, it's getting more and more open and shows the internal gardens, internal courtyards, that serves also as a kind of climatic buffers and has an impact on the climate inside the building. And we are a little bit impressed by the buildings like Schinkel's Altes Museum, a kind of space containing blocks where you can see building structure and you can imagine what is the structure of the building inside, even though that there are no too much glazing. And here's the result. It's the first phase of after the phase of construction. I like this photographs, this photograph, because it shows that during the evening, it's even difficult to say where is the external and where is the internal part of this building. Here are some, you can see some atriums and places for office work, and you can see also a lot of social areas like fitness with swimming pool, the library, and some atmospheric photographs taken by a photographer, Juliusz Sokołowski. We're collaborating with him for many years, and shows the different moods during the rain and sun. And the thing that we wanted to achieve is the multisensoric character of this building. So we are saying to the people in Agora that you are journalists, you are creating an artificial world of media, and we'll give you something very, very real, very material. And that's why this building is built with a lot of natural materials like weathering wood, galvanized steel, concrete, a lot of greenery, and this building smells completely different in the rain, in the sun, in the winter. It's very sensual. Okay. And the interior, it is in fact a kind of three-dimensional matrix with a lot of function, a lot of internal atriums, external atriums. Here you can see internal atrium with a cascade of gardens open to the main hall, the entrance hall, which is designed as a kind of partly public street with cafeteria, with cafe, with library, with conference rooms, and so on. And another cultural building. This is the library. This is the Raczyński Library in Poznań. It's also a result of the competition. And the old building, founded by Earl Raczyński in the middle of 19th century, that was one of the most important, or maybe the most important, cultural institution in Poznań at times. The times where Poland lost its independence. And our intention was to left this building, which is a little bit similar to the southern facade of Louvre and has a very interesting details, cast iron columns, a little bit shifted pattern of windows on the backside. We wanted to leave this as a main entrance. And our task was to build something like new books, magazines, and new public space. And the program was about five times bigger than in the old building. The old building was was destroyed during the war. The only front facade remains. The rest was reconstructed in social realistic manner after the war. And our idea was to follow the general rules of the old building, that is like the palace-like building with this ceremonial first floor, the kind of piano nobile, and we wanted to follow this main public and ceremonial space at the same level. So you can see here, you can see the new piano nobile of our building, and you can see the view from the catalog space and reading room space towards the old part of the building. After the competition, during the design works, we removed all the columns from this area. So this building sits at the four legs. In each leg, there are staircases, ventilation ducts, and lifts. But this space is free from any columns to emphasize the meaning of this area, and the library and the reading room along the facade, showing the old building. And this is something interesting. This is our three-dimensional concrete facade, and here you can see a brick tower of Royal Castle in Poznań that is built something like 5 years after our new wing of library. And I think the image of this building is based at the images found at the old coins. It's not very precise reconstruction, because nobody knows how the castle looks like, really. And some facade patterns showing how we are playing with the textures, the concrete, three-dimensional concrete elements in different positions at the ground floor and at the reading room level. And so this is the front side of the building, and this is the rear side of the building, where we use also concrete, but in the form of horizontal strips of concrete brick. And another space containing block designed 15 years after Agora building. It's a Polish embassy in Berlin, competition design. We hope that that the construction works will start this year, hopefully. And it's a little bit similar concept to the Agora building. The double facade that covers the courtyards, and of course this facade is completely different. It's a different place. The most ceremonial area in historical building, Unter den Linden, one of the most important streets, with a very strict urban regulation, and the building that is embassy, so it has different order than Agora building, but it shows some similarities, like this courtyard, on the entrance courtyard on the second plan, and this shimmering facade, three-dimensional facade. And here you can see the photographs of the model and the renderings showing the public spaces of the embassy, the entrance zone, the exhibition space. And it's also possible that in the next phase of designing, we'll find a place for Polish Institute in this building as well. And one of our last competition design, the building for the Warsaw University, and a bit similar idea of internal atriums that are a little bit like a cascade, and this cascade is open visually to the public entrance zone, public entrance hall, and in this to which are well, there are a lot of public functions there, like restaurant, bars, library, and so on. And some and two examples of our dwelling houses. I'm showing it because I want to tell a few words about the Warsaw, our struggles with Warsaw planning system. This is a Wilanowska, Wilanowska street housing estate. What is characteristic for this design? That it is, that it sits on the former agricultural ground. So you have, if you are flying above the Poland, you may see a lot of pictures like that with this pattern of the long, narrow strips of land. And here is our housing estate. And here's the neighborhood. The housing estate stagnated, one of the biggest housing estates from 1970s, built of, on consolidated ground, of course. And these are the new housing complexes, housing estates from 1990s that are built on the land bought from the farmers' families, step by step. And so we called this kind of urbanism, urbanistika wanowa, which means agricultural urbanism or something like that. And what is important that the street facade where we had to design according to the city master planning description, which was very detailed, but the rest we are free to decide, but this freedom was not was a little bit stopped by the developer, who decided to leave the agricultural the former agricultural partitions, because he was selling a flat together with a part of the land, and that was much more easier for him to keep the former ownership borders. So we decided to design the interior of this block by providing two pedestrian paths that leading from the street side to the waterway, which is here, and which links this area with the open green fields that are connected with the new district of Wilanów, and then with the forest complexes in the southern part of the city. And what is interesting, that there are still a lot of wild animals, and we can even say that it's a kind of invasion of wild animals to the center of the city. So you can, it's about 5 kilometers to the center of Warsaw, the Palace of Culture, and you can meet deer, wild boars, pheasants, foxes, hedgehogs, and all these wild animals. And here you can see the interior of this housing estate. We decided to apply this a little bit folded shape of facade that goes well with wooden shutters. Settled on different angles and provided some privacy for the dwellers. And another picture showing the internal pedestrian pathways with a transparent staircase with a view to the green areas. And completely different story. Another dwelling house. It's our first flatiron building in our career. Here is marked with the red color, and it's completely different area. It's one of the most monumental places in Warsaw, a district built in 1950s during the social realistic period. This is the main south-north axis of Warsaw, and we call this part of town Brukalski Canyon, from the name of the architect Stanisław Brukalski, who designed it in 50s. And what is interesting, that Brukalski was one of the pioneers of the Warsaw modernism from 1920s. And here you can see his Brukalski Canyon buildings from 53, and his own house designed together with his wife, Barbara Brukalska, also professor of our School of Architecture. Designed more or less the same time as famous Rietveld house in Utrecht, with a very interesting central staircase, and Brukalski social housing for also from 20s and 30s. It's very interesting. And what was our problem? Our problem was it's another problem with the master planning. The city planners ask for the building who has a tower, 16 floors, and a kind of pedestal podium, 8 floors, and the proportions were almost 1 to 1 to 1 to 1, very uncomfortable for architects. So we were making a lot of studies how to struggle with these proportions, and we decided that that the typical division of the facade, the ground floor, the main floors, and the mezzanine doesn't work in this case. It's too monumental, and it's not got response for this social realistic building in the neighborhood. And we are studying a lot of Warsaw architecture from 1930s, the monumental Warsaw architecture from 30s, some ex-German expressionist buildings, Chicago buildings, to find the proper solution. And finally, we decide to divide this building into the 4 stories blocks, a little bit shifted against themselves, divide it with a narrow slits, with openings to the internal courtyard, with some balconies, lodges. It's not this way, okay. And here's the result. Here you can see the context of Brukalski Canyon, and our building divided into 4 stories blocks with this openings filled with lodges. And one of our last buildings, it's a reconstruction of the old market hall in the city of Warsaw. The city of Warsaw sold this building to the developer, and the developer moved the steel structure to the storages outside the Warsaw, and dismantled the majority of the building. Some parts, like the facades from the streets, of facades of 2 pavilions that are adjacent to the streets, remains. But practically for 5 years, this building were in a ruined state, and the people who bought this market hall decided to turn it to the shopping center. We thought that it's not a good idea, and after years of negotiations with our client, we decided to make a kind of food hall that links a food market with restaurants, bars, and so on. It is, of course, a kind of gentrification of this building, but it makes it works. And what is important, that there are a lot of sentimental reactions of the people living in the neighborhood. For us architects, that was also a very sentimental project because our school of architecture is something like 100 meters from here, and we spent our studies drinking beer here. And so that was very important. And we decided to use the same brick of old building and to apply all structural elements made of cast iron as well. And what was very important that we were restore or build a new pathwork of new pattern of public passageways, narrow alleys, narrow passages linking the buildings inside a quarter. It's very important in Warsaw because in Warsaw there's a lack of such spaces. It's not a Prague where you can find a lot of passageways, and in Warsaw it's this place stays very popular because of such atmospheres, of such urban block interiors. And the last design I want to show is one of our last designs, and it is the same part of the city of Warsaw I show you at the first photographs. This is the part of Warsaw that changes drastically 5 times within the last 200 years, from this little village-like character to the very dense late 19th century city, through the destruction during the Second World War, then dwelling houses from 1960s, and new development of 1990s and 2000s. And what is interesting that this new development, it's a kind of a negative space comparing it with a 19th century city. We wanted to there's an old synagogue also from 19th century. And this is a project for the Jewish community in Warsaw. And first of all, we wanted to bring back the atmosphere of the narrow spaces, of narrow courtyards, narrow passageways, narrow alleys, because the old synagogue was always accessible through this kind of spaces. So we decided to restore an atmosphere of and the proportions of that spaces. There were lots of sources of inspiration, like a synagogues designed by Louis Kahn, and also the synagogues, the wooden synagogues from Eastern Poland, that are very characteristic and very unusual with this specific wooden domes, and this is something that is typical only for this, or rather that was typical for this part of Poland, for the eastern part of Poland, and the results. And we are spending a lot of time discussing with the Jewish community about the character of the space and about the symbolic elements, because they were very sensitive to the public appearance of this building, to the facade patterns, to the way they want to expose the new synagogue, which is a part of the new Jewish community center, and the ways we can see the old synagogue through the gates, through the narrow passageways. So that's the kind of record from the meetings of the community. And that was the last project I wanted to show you. I'm afraid I was talking too long. Sorry for that. And thank you very much for your attention.
A tak děkuji za pozornost, kterou jste tady věnovali. Já ještě využiju možnost a pozvu vás na ještě jednu akci, která se bude konat teďka na konci školního pololetí. Před prázdninama máme tady kemp pro šotouše, takže pokud jste fanoušci veřejné dopravy, tak budeme tady mít vlastní linku autobusovou číslo 51, což je číslo popisné kempu a IPRu. A budete se moct projet starým autobusem Praga RND z roku 1945 a budou tady komentované projekce z oblíbené tramvaje Mazačka. Takže vás všechny zvu, podívejte se na Facebook, a událost už tam je. A takže ještě jednou děkuju, a přeju vám všem dobrou noc a doufám, že se příště zase uvidíme. Naschledanou. Tak se ještě omlouvám, jak jsem říkal, tak jsem tady moc krátce, mám být ještě diskuze. Takže děkuji za první trapas. Náš mluvčí se aspoň občerstvil. Pokud budete mít dotaz, já vám donesu mikrofon a náš řečník vám odpoví. Takže se ještě jednou omlouvám. So, do you have any questions? Yeah, first.
Hello, thank you for your presentation. We appreciate it. And recently we have been also to Warsaw and we have seen some of your realizations and we appreciate it really much. So thank you for that. I just want to ask you, how exactly functions the process when you want to build something in Poland? Because it looks like it is pretty much easier than here. Here there are some complications in the process, some like interest groups, some political interests and so on, some really fights between developers, publics, and so on. So could you please describe this situation in Poland? Thank you.
I think everywhere it's a kind of nightmare for architects, of course. And yes, it is more or less the same. Of course, it depends on a particular project. In case of, of course, it's easier in the places of the town that are covered with a master plan, because it limits the scope of the field of discussion. But there are not so many places like that in Warsaw. And frankly saying, developers are not very interested in extending this this areas covered with the master plan. It's understandable. And when there were no master planning, it's much more difficult because we are always we have always to apply for the special permission, and the neighbors of the buildings and sometimes the local communities, of course, have to express their opinions about it, and sometimes it's a very long process. Mm-hmm. But unfortunately, I must say that unfortunately we don't have such a place like here in camp to organize the discussions for the local communities, for the citizens of Warsaw, and we don't have a culture of discussion, procedures, and so on, so on. So each time it's a bit different. Sometimes the process of obtaining the building permit took half years, and sometimes it's a question of 8 years or even more. always it's difficult. The most difficult position, looking from the architect's point of view, is with public buildings built by public funds, because there is a public procurement law that makes the institutional clients to choose the cheapest construction manager, the cheapest contractor, and I think it's everywhere. And but in case of Warsaw projects, we had a lot of troubles with this, and I must say that sometimes the contracts signed by general contractors were for about 50% of our initial budget, which is real catastrophe. And sometimes it is a source of very serious troubles during the construction time, and of course it has an impact of the quality of works. In the case of, for example, of Academy of Fine Arts in Warsaw, we had a lot of troubles with the quality of works, and we are not very happy with a lot of details. We are trying not to look very precisely at this building. Yes. So it is a problem. The new architect of Warsaw, Marlena Hapak, is an architect who works for many years in her small private office that is specialized in participation projects. So she understands the she's even a little bit crazy about it, but sitting in her new office in a new position, she found that it's not as easy as she was saying, being an activist and an architect making a participation project.
Thank you.
So, another questions? No one? It should be discussion. Yes? Oh. Great.
Good evening. Thank you for your presentation. I would like to ask you, how are you working with landscape architecture or environment around the building? And if you have in your company also landscape architects?
Yes, of course, we are working with landscape architects, and we are two or three offices. We are working permanently since 20, 15 years. And they are simply a part of our team, and we are trying to engage landscape architects from the very beginning, from the conceptual stage of the most of our buildings. And for example, in this Agora building, the one for multimedia group, the concept of internal atriums, the external gardens were very much influenced by our landscape architects. So we appreciate the work with them.
Okay, another one? You have questions? Maybe I have one. As I asked you before, you have written that something about fulfilling of potential of architecture. Mm-hmm. Do you think there is any architectural object in Prague from past 10 years that fulfilled the potential of architecture?
No, I'm not an expert here. This is something I want to ask you, really, what to see tomorrow, for example, well, must see in Prague, in the new buildings. I've seen the new technical library where our exhibition is and the adjacent architectural school. And I must say that I was very impressed, especially by the interiors of the library that are formal in some ways, but also very spontaneous. And it is a very sober building and with a bit of craziness. And I like especially the way the interiors were treated. That you have a very strong concrete columns, very exposed to the floors, the slabs, and a very spontaneous way of arranging the interiors with the lighting fixtures, with visual information, and so on, so on. And also the architectural school building is also very impressive. It's like Louis Kahn monumentality. And on the other hand, I feel that the student studios are very cozy and intimate spaces. So I think that this is a great potential. type of architecture.
Yeah, thank you. Do you have another question? Something about Prague, new projects? Yeah?
Hello. I have a question. If you ever participate in any architectural competitions, like in Czech Republic or the neighboring countries to Poland?
Yes, we have participated in some competitions abroad, and one in Prague for the Congress extension of the Congress Center. Unfortunately, we were not awarded, and we are participating in a competition, for example, for the Great Egyptian Museum. I remember that at the very beginning, something like 25 years ago, we received a prize in competition for the expo in Vienna. I don't remember exactly the year. And for us young architects, we were working as a group of, let's say, 15 people that time. That was very important because we received the prize, and there were a lot of very famous architects in this competition, like Lorenzo Piano, Jean Nouvel, and other, and we feel very strong after. And so. Sometimes we do, but we haven't won the first prize in any international competitions.
Another question, another topic that you're interested in. I will use another from my questions. Is there anything that you can say to young people, to young students who want to establish their own architecture studio? Is there, because your studio is 30 years old now, yeah. So it's a nice piece of history. And do you have any advice, something to say to them? Maybe, you know, time changes. So what's different from the time when you when you try to establish your studio, and it was different to
have to speak with mentor's voice. My advice: don't think about it too much. Don't even try. Of course, you will find a way to establish your own studio if you are talented and with a little bit luck. But first of all, don't concentrate of establishing your own studio. Be concentrated on on your architectural ideas, developed your own ideas, tried to be try to discuss your ideas with the group of people you like to talk to them. And what is, I think, the most important thing is to participating in the competition, of course, but also establish good relationship with people you are working with, and look for the proper people you are working with. It doesn't mean that these people have to think like you are thinking. It's not a good a solution. It's very easy to establish architectural practice, but it's certainly it's not very easy to work and live with such people for 30 years. I think it's be true to yourself.
Okay, yeah, another question here.
Thank you for the exposition, it was really nice. I just have one question about the Katowice Conference Center. You mentioned there were some coal mines before construction. I wonder how, what happened to them, or if there was any treatment before the project?
The nearest coal mine, called Katowice coal mine, one of the biggest in the town, is turned to the Silesian Museum by Austrian architects Riegler and River, who won the competition. Some are closed and some are still working. The Katowice is still a big industrial town with a lot of coal mines, steelworks, and so on.
Okay, another topic, another question. No one? All satisfied? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.